Hello guys, welcome to Core Python Training Part 2. In the last day, what we watched, what is Python, what is Python IDE, how to start Jupyter Notebook in different ways, then introduction to Python, like where Python is used and how it is used, for which components we can use it, also what are the applications of Python, then variables. How to define variables in Python, then some simple mathematical operations such as plus or addition, negation, subtraction, division, multiplication, and nth power of something, such operations and strings and some basic information about strings. So last day we covered all these points, and for today we are going to have watch data structures, then conditional statements. Okay, so mainly there are three type of data structures. One is lists, second is tuples, and third is a dictionary. And in conditional statements, we are basically going to see how if statements work, then how if else statement works, then and how nested if else statement works, and how multiple if else statements works. Okay. So today we are going to cover all these points. I will keep looping statements for next video. Okay, so basically data structures. What is a data structure? Data structure is that which allows you to organize your data in such a way that enables you to store collections of data related collections of data. Okay. So basically there are three types of data structures, such as lists, tuples, and dictionaries. So what is a list? A list is a data structure in Python, is a ordered sequence of elements that we can store elements one by one in a list format. And what is it helpful for? It is helpful for storing data sequentially. I consider I am using something something iteratively, and I wanted to extract last element of that particular previous iteration. So in such a scenarios, we can use lists to store our information. Okay, so now how the indexing starts in lists. So the indexing starts in entire Python programming, the indexing starts from 0 1 2 3 4 5, like that, not like 1 2 3 4 5. Like, consider I have stored five elements in a list, and I wanted to know the index positions of each and every element. Then then I have to keep in mind that the index position is always going to be, if I wanted to extract the nth element, then index position for that nth element will be n-1. So consider if I wanted to extract fifth element, so I have to provide an index of a 4, like 5 minus 1, that is 4. Okay, so what are basic properties of a list, or information about list? Like, each element that is inside a list is called an item. Whatever we store in a list, that is called as an item. Lists are defined by having values between square brackets. Okay, so whenever we define a list, we are going to define it in a square brackets, and each and every item in that list is going to be separated by commas. Okay, so also we have to make sure we have to know that lists are mutable. That means we can change values in a list. Okay, like, consider if I want to replace a value at nth position, so that can be done in list, but not in tuples and strings. Okay, so this is basic information about list. So let us define a list. Okay, so consider I define a list. Like, how we define a list? We have to define it in a square brackets. So I have placed a square brackets over here like this, and now I have to provide each and every element with comma separated, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So I want to have this list. Okay, so I will have 6 elements into it, and this is my list. And if I wanted to print a list or print whatever value of an variable is, so I can use print statement, or I have to use that variable in the last line of that cell. So the values, whatever a value store into that cell, are printed automatically. Okay, so this is how we print a list. So this is our list, which is having 6 elements. Okay, so also if consider I want to create an empty list, so for that I have to use just the square brackets, and there is no need to place any item into that square bracket, and this is how we can create an empty list. Okay, so here is list one, which is just having which is defined like just only square brackets. So this is this list is empty. Also if I wanted to know what is the type of this list one, because it is empty list, but I wanted to know whether it is a list type or not. So for that we can use the type statement. Okay, so type list1, list1. So this will give me what is the type of this variable, and the type of this variable was a list type. Okay, so if I wanted to know how many number of elements there are in a list, so for that there is an inbuilt function available in Python having named len. So len means length, we can call it length or number of elements in a list, or whatever we are we want to know the number of elements. Like this len function is applicable in strings, it is applicable in tuples also. Okay, so basically it answers us, or it gives us the number of how many elements are present into that particular variable. Okay, so here our variable is lst, and I want to know how many elements are present into it. So I have used the len statement, and it gives me that there are 6 elements present. Okay, so here we can see that there are 6 elements present, 1 2 3 4 5 6. Okay, so that's how. Now consider if I want to replace an element at nth position. Okay, so for that I can use index position of that particular element. Like if I want to remove third element or third item, so index position for that third item will be n-1. Here n is 3, so 3-1. So we can replace the third element like this. I want to replace this element with 10. Okay, so my newly formed list will be having this 10 value 10 at a third position. Similarly, if I wanted to replace an element at fifth position, so for that I have to give a command of lst4. That 4 means I am going to replace an item which is at fifth position, but by the index value of that fifth position is 4, because index value is always n-1. Okay, and I wanted to change it to like 100, and I wanted to print my list, newly obtained the list. So I have placed this lst command, and here we can see that the value at fifth position has got changed to 100. Also we can revert, or we can do this do the commands in reverse order also, but we have to keep it in mind that our index position is previously one, previously whatever we placed, and we should also know the what was previous value over here. Okay, so the previous value was 5, so we get our previous list also. Okay, so how to extract an element from a list. Okay, so for extracting elements, we can extract elements from list using index positions. So basically there are indexing in a list. Indexing is done in two ways, like in a normal way and in reverse order. Okay, so if the index position is written in minus format or negative format, then it is we are going to extract entities from or items from that list in reverse order. Or and if the number is positive, then we are extracting the element in the regular way. Okay, so here, like if I wanted to extract 5, So here, if I wanted to extract the fifth element from a list, so for that I have to give an index number 4, and I and this will give me what is the fifth element present in that list. Okay, so and if I wanted to similarly, if I wanted to extract like second element in that list, so for that I would like to have my index position for second element will be 1, and I will get that second element which is 2. Okay, by the way, if I want to get the last element of that list, so for that my index position will be -1. Okay, so whenever we use inverse indexing, so for inverse indexing in Python, the indexing method starts from -1, -2, -3, -4, like that onwards. Okay, but in normal indexing, the indexing starts from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and for inverse indexing, the index starts from -1, -2, -3, -4. Okay, because so this is how we can get a last element or extract last element item from a list. Okay, so for extracting last element, we can have a -1 statement. Also, there is another way of extracting last element from a list that I have to know. Like, consider this is my list, okay, and I have to know what is length of list, or this len command will give me how many number of elements are stored into that list, but that that number will be exactly like previously we know that there are 6 elements provided into my list, and I want to extract last element. So for that, my index position will be like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This number will be positive. So my index position will be 0, 1, 2, 5. Okay, up to 5. So for that, we have to provide -1 over here. Like length of LST will give us a number. The number will be 6. And I want to extract the 6th number. So for that, my index position will be 6 minus 1. Okay, so this is how we can extract and last element. This is another way of extracting last element from a list. Okay, so consider I want to append a new list to my previous list. So there are two ways of appending a list. So basically what we can do, we can use just a simple plus sign and then provide another list. So this is also list a list of 3 elements which are having items 15, 13 and 19, and I wanted to add these elements into my previously obtained list. So my previously obtained list is LST and I want to add it into it. So basically if I give only this command, whatever I have selected, this will just show us a new list, but the items or the new list will not be assigned to any variable, so we have to assign it to this one. So I will just elaborate how it works. Okay, so consider if I am using only this command, so it will just print out the entire numbers. Okay, previously my previous list was having 6 elements, like 1 2 3 4 5 6, okay, up to here, and here we can see there are 3 new variables into it. But again, like if I print my previous list, so there will not be any change into it, because we have just printed whatever operation we did into this shell, but it has not got assigned to any other variable or list. So now if I want to add new list to previous list, so for that I have to use this statement, but I have to assign this whole whatever outcome of this whole statement is to the previous list. Okay, so for that we have used this command over here, LST is equal to LST plus this, and this is how we will get a new list which is having like 9 elements. Now here we can't easily calculate how many number of elements are there, so in such scenarios the length function comes into picture. Okay, Now consider if I wanted to add a single item into a list. So for adding a single item, we can use dot append command, which is inbuilt command in Python. So here I have my list, first one list, that LST, and I want to append a new value, new item 500 into it. So here we can see, if I run this command, we can see that this 500 item has got appended, added to my previous list at the last position. Okay, so whatever we append, that item enters into last position into the list. Now again, if I wanted to append, now you know that we previously defined a new list, like list one, and which one was empty. Now if I wanted to append this list with a name Sri, so, or hello, so, and now I want to print this list one. So here we can see now list one is having one more element into it, which is named hello, which is a string type. Okay, so this is how we can define we can add single items into a list. Okay, so this is it. Now also we can see we can define different type of strings. There is no constraint of what data type should be of a string into a list. The items can be of integer type, can be of a float type, or can be of string type. So basically, to show you this thing, we have developed this one example, that now we can see the four items into this list are of integer type, while the fifth item is Sri, and which is a string, and the last item is a float type. So basically, we can define string this way also. Okay. Now I will define one more list, like vision. I have splitted each and every word of our company, like vision, computer vision, vision NLP. So here we can see we have a new list having vision N L and P. Okay, so this is my new list. And now if I wanted to remove a particular item from that list, like if I wanted to remove this item I from my previous list, so we have to see how this works, because there are multiple I's present into my list. So how exactly it will react? So basically, it will remove the first one item. Okay, so this remove function works in a regular way, or in a straight line path. It will move from LHS to RHS, and it will remove whichever item is at first position. Here we can see that there are multiple I's. Here are two I's in vision, so VISION. So and I want to remove and I from this list. So my operation started from the left hand side. So it checked whether at first position is there a character I present or not, and then it was not the I, that's why it didn't remove it. But the second item was I, so it removed it, and our function got stopped. Okay, whatever we were doing, that got stopped, and thus all the elements which were remaining were appended into the same list. Okay, so this is how we can remove an element from a list. Okay, so if I do this command one more time, it will remove now the another I, which one was left. Okay, so this is how we can remove a item into a list. Okay, so now if I wanted to if I wanted to append a duplicate of my previous list to the same list, so for that we can use this dot star list star two command, and what it will do, it will just keep all the elements which one were present in previously also, and it will append the same elements afterwards also. Okay, so here we can see that up to P all the elements are are the original elements, and after the p the elements have got added one more time. Okay, so this is how the star 2 or multiplication works. Okay, so now consider if I want to add this into 3. So for that, here we can see that the previous elements have got replicated 3 times or thrice. So this is how multiplication operation works in onto a list. Okay, so now how we can append new items into list. So for that we can use dot and dot append method, or we can use a plus method. Okay, so we can append strings to a list, or we can append any other data type to a list. Okay, so here is my list 1, which is like welcome to vision. And now if I want to add NLP new string NLP over it, so I have to use this dot append function and NLP. Okay, now we will check whether there is any problem if I provide this in single quotation. So no, there is no any problem. But if I am printing something and if I vary the quotation marks, then there will be definitely a problem. Okay, now if I want to reverse the order of our list, so for that we can use dot reverse function, and it will just reverse the order of items placed into that list. Okay, so our previous list was the one list was having items called welcome to vision NLP, and after using dot reverse function we have new items like NLP vision to welcome. Okay, so this doesn't make sense in particular this one example, but this is one method to show. Okay, now how can we sort a list? But for sorting purpose, the data type of list must have has to be same. Okay, so now for this particular list I use dot sort function, and we can see that it has sorted the list in ascending order. Okay, now consider I have a list which is having mixed data types. Some elements are integer and some are string like hello. So what it will do, it will throw an error that sorting between instances for strings and integer. Okay, so sorting cannot be done on different data type or a variety of data types into a single list, but sorting can be done on single, if there is a single type of data type of items. Okay, so our previous example was better to know whether this sorting how the sorting can be done. Okay, so next data type is tuples. What is a tuple? Okay, so this is also a sequence of a Python objects, and tuple is more similar to list, but except one thing is that lists are defined in square brackets, where tuples are defined in parentheses. Okay, also there are some property changes between lists and tuples, that tuples are immutable. That means we cannot change or replace a value at particular position into a tuple, but we can change a value at particular position in a list. Okay, so here the meaning of mutable is if we can change a value at particular position, then that type of data type is called mutable data type. But if we cannot change a value at a particular data type, then we will say that data type is immutable data type. Okay, again this creating of tuple is nearly similar, but we have to use parentheses. Okay, and when tuples are used to gather group together related data, such as numbers or ages or names of peoples. Okay, so we can place this type of information in a tuple, because names is a single type of or a related data. Age is also related data, like age of one man, or age of mother and father, age of whatever classmates, like that. So this is a related data, that's why we can place it using we can to store such a type of information we can use tuples. Okay, so let us define a tuple. So we have to define a tuple in same way like list, but we have to change we have to define it in square in a parenthesis. So this is my tuple. Like I can add elements into this tuple like 12, 15, 19, like this. And now my new tuple will be having these how many elements I have, like for checking how many elements, if I am not able to count how many elements are there in a list, so for that we can use len function. Okay, so here I have this length function. Come on, okay, so we wanted to check how many number of elements there are into a tuple or into a list. And so basically there is this common function we can use to extract number of elements into a tuple or into a list. So for that we can use this length function, and here we can see that there are 8 elements present into that. Again, if I wanted to know data type of any variable like previously I defined some variables like LST1, LST2, then LIST1, then any variable. So for that, I can use this type function and the variable name into the parentheses, and I will the function will return us the type of that particular variable. Okay, so here we can check it like type of my list one function, list one variable which I defined here previously. So here we can see the type of list one function is a list type. Okay, now how can I extract second element or second letter from a tuple, second item from a tuple? So as I stated previously also, that each and every each and every data type follows the same structure of indexing. The indexing in normal way will start from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and indexing in inverse order will start from minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. And so in a regular way, if I wanted to extract nth element, the index position for that nth element will be n minus 1. So here if I wanted to have a second element, my index position for second element will be my tuple 2 minus 1, that is my tuple 1, and my second element from my tuple will be 1. Okay, so basically why I choose this one particular example, because here my tuple was tuple also, items in the tuple also starts from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's why it's easy to understand to how indexing also works. Okay, now if I wanted to change a number, change an item at second position or third position, so for that I can use the same method. But as I showed, as I told you before, we can't change or we can't assign new object, new item to previous items. That there is a property of a tuple which means which tells us that tuples are immutable. Immutable means we can't change change items from the tuples. So for that, because of that, this error throws that type error, tuple object does not support item assignment. Okay, so whenever if you are also in onto this using this Jupyter notebook, and if this type of error throws, so don't bother, you have to just read what is that error. If that error tells you that tuple object does not support item type, so here you can know that you are doing something wrong. If a tuple object, we are not able to assign new object to a position, to a defined position in a tuple, so our method is wrong. We can't define, we can't change an object into a tuple. But if we want to follow the same way, we have to change the tuple into a list, okay, and then we can follow this method of item assignment, okay. Now how to append tuples, okay. So for appending tuples we can use the same method what we used for appending list or adding list into a list, okay. So here we can use the plus sign and we can see a new tuple with different with added three numbers, okay. So the three numbers are added 0, 2, and 3, but all this information was not stored in my tuple. Here we can see that because this is just printing whatever we have executed over here, but it is not storing the information what we executed above, okay. So this can be justified using this command. Here we can see that these three elements are not permanently added because this is just printing. Whatever this has done is just printing. So if I seriously wanted to append or add these elements into my tuple, so I have to use this command like my tuple equal to my tuple plus new tuple, okay. So this way we can add elements permanently, okay. Here we can see that these elements are added into my tuple permanently, okay. Now can we add tuple into list? The answer is no, because there will be an error in data type. We can't add list into tuple or tuple into list because there is an error of data types, okay. So you have to make sure that if there is a error which shows like type error, so you have to make sure that you built an habit of understanding of reading that error, okay. So what this error says that can only concatenate tuples not list, okay. So this means that our previous object is a tuple type, and if I wanted to add something to it, then whatever I wanted to add into that previous one, the that item should be a tuple type, not a list type or not any other type. Not, it can be dictionary or it cannot be any other type, okay. So this is how we this is the meaning of this error, okay. Now let us see that whether we can apply dot append function. Is there any way of applying dot append function? If I wanted to add a single item into my previous tuple, what are ways of adding it? So my previous tuple is my newly formed tuple is new tuple, and I want to append something, append or add new item to it. So I want to append like 10, but it will show an attribute error that tuple object does not have an attribute append. Okay, what does this error means? So this error means that we cannot add a new item into a tuple. But we can add a new tuple into tuple, but we cannot add new item using dot append command. Okay. So now if I wanted to add a new item into a tuple, I have to use this plus command and new tuple equal to new tuple plus 10, okay. So this way we can add, no, this way also there is some can only concatenate tuple not integer. So what I am adding is this is considered as a tuple, but not this is not considered as a tuple, this is considered as just an integer. So that's why this error was. But if I form this entire another thing or whatever we are adding into a tuple, so that way we can add here, there is no mistake, because if I place some place any variable into parentheses, like let us check like type of whatever I place into a parenthesis, okay. So the type will be I think integer type. But if I add comma and any value, any different value, then the type of this parenthesis, whatever value stored into this parenthesis, will get changed into tuple, okay. So the previous error was because of just a single value into parenthesis, and if we place a single value into parenthesis, Python dramatically takes that value as integer type or whatever value type we have defined, but it will not consider it as a tuple type. So for defining a tuple, we have to place at least two items like a and b or whatever, one or two, one plus two, or like that. But there cannot be just a single item. If we place the single item, the type of or variable type of that particular item will be considered as variable type of whole parenthesis. Okay, like consider I place here like hello. So the variable type of all these whatever into these brackets are, that will be considered as string. So into tuples there are there is this condition that there must be a tuple must have at least two items. In other ways, list can be a empty list. Okay, like we previously defined also lst equal to this. This also works, and the data type of lst will be a list type. But consider I am defining a tuple, but I tup, and this is empty tuple, and I wanted to know the variable type of a tuple, the previously one previously defined variable. So the data type will be tuple, but if I press like just single element into it, the variable type will get changed. So there can be zero or two elements. Minimum number of elements into tuple is two. We can say the minimum number of elements can be placed into a tuple will be two or more than two, but it cannot be less than two. Okay, so this is some new information for me also. So now let us move on to third data type, which is a dictionary type. Okay, so what is a dictionary? Dictionary is an unordered collection of data values used to store values with one-to-one mapping. Okay, so whenever we store information using one-to-one mapping, and we wanted to know just that we don't want to store more information about something or the background information about something, but we have to we are going to store only the index names or some unique identification name of some people. So for such a scenarios we can use dictionaries. Okay, like consider I am storing information about 10 people and their marks. Okay, so then consider my one student is Vinayak, and I store the information using Vinayak. Okay, and so here Vinayak will be kept as a key, and whatever values of his grades are, that will be stored into a list format or into a tuple format, and that values will be integer type. Okay, so here then consider my second student is like Harish, and I want to store his information also. So my new key will be Harish, and whatever his grades are, that will be placed into values values, and it will be it can be a tuple or list or anything. Okay, so here what I have to know is I have to know the key names. Okay, so here Vinayak and Harish are two different unique key names. So you have to always know that keys in a dictionary are unique keys. If I if I want to change a key, or if my two keys are same, if I try to keep two keys same, it will not happen, it will not work. Okay, so also we can store data into a dictionary which is not which is unordered. There is no need of any some particular order order to store data. Okay, so basically Python in Python dictionaries are defined into two elements. The first element is key and the second element is values. Okay, so basically in my last example, my keys were Vinayak and Harish, and my values were whatever the grades they had obtained. Okay, now key is a single element. Key is always a single element. Okay, like it can be a string, or it can be a number, or it can be string, or it can be a number. but it cannot be a least. But whatever we want to store into values, that can be a number or that can be a single string or that can be a list. Okay, so here there is or that can be dictionary also. Okay, so here is one twist we have to always know, that keys are numbers or strings, but whatever values we want to store with one-to-one mapping with that key can be a number, can be a string, or can be a list. Okay, so let us define a string. So how string, let us define a dictionary. So basically how dictionary is defined, dictionary is always defined into curly brackets. Okay, then values stored or keys are always kept in the first position, then keys and values are separated by colons. Okay, so let us define a dictionary over here. So here is my dictionary named dict. Okay, the first key into my dictionary is red, and I wanted to keep a value 1 2 3 for that key. Okay, now I want to add a new key blue, and I want to add value 301 to that to that key. Okay, now my third key is green, and value assigned to that third key is 255. My fourth key is white, and value assigned to white is 500. Now if I wanted to add a new key, like if I wanted to add a key as a number, then my key will be 155, and value assigned to that key can be a string or can be a list or can be a number. Okay, so here I will like to write a hello world string. I am assigning a new value to this particular key. Okay, now if I want to have a have another one key, I want to define new key. Now consider I define a key as 153, and value stored into that key can be a list also, so I will assign a list as a value of that particular key. Okay, so my list will be 3 4 5 5 5 and 6. Okay, so and if I run this command, here we can see that there is no any error. So as I previously stated, this method can work. Okay, so this is how we can store different values in using the keys. Okay, so now here we can see that there are five or six different keys, and I wanted to know only the key names of and dictionary. So for that we can use dot keys function to extract the key names of a dictionary. Okay, so to extract key names of a dictionary. So to extract key names of a dictionary, we can use dot keys function. So here we can see there are 6 keys. Okay, so if I wanted to know that type of this particular dot keys, whatever the return is, then we can use this type function, and it will show us that the type of this key dict dot keys function is a dict keys type. Okay, so this is how we can extract keys. Okay, so when does this method is useful? If I want to know, consider my dictionary is very very big, it is having like 500 keys, and I want to values of each and every key is a list. So while printing that list, it will be a problematic to understand whether what is key and what is the value assigned to that, and that might make a problem. And that's why just to extract the keys, we can use dot keys function over there. Okay, now we can change values whatever assigned to a key. Okay, so previously my value to key red was 123, and I wanted to change that value to 321. So for that we can use this method. This method is nearly similar to list, but in a list we used indexing over here, but in dictionaries we have to use the keys over here, keys into the square brackets. Okay, so you have to make sure, or you have to just mark these things, that whenever you are dealing with dictionaries, you have to provide key names into square brackets, and if you are dealing with a list, then you have to provide index number, index position of that particular element. Okay, so this is how we can change and change an element into a list, change value of an key. Okay, now if I want to print a dictionary, then we can use like only dicta function, or we can use if I wanted to print a dictionary using I wanted to know what are items stored into a dictionary, then we can use dicta.items function, and it will use it will provide also the same way, but in square brackets it will provide us a pair of keys and values stored at a particular location. Okay, so here we can see that the key in the first item which we have stored into dictionary is this first item, and its key is red and its value is 321. The second item is this whole item, its key is blue and its value is 301. Okay, similarly likewise. Now if I wanted to add a different key, or if I wanted to add one more value into that dictionary, then I have to keep in mind that my key name should be different. Okay, and I can assign a new string or new value, whatever I want, to that particular key. Here my new key name is 673, and I want to assign it a value string. Okay, so string yellow. Here our new dictionary will be having 7 different keys, like red, blue, green, white, 155, 153, and 673, and the value is value assigned to it is yellow. Okay, now can we assign a tuple to a value? Okay, so here I have defined previously 155 object, and I wanted to assign change the value of this key 155, and I wanted to change it from string to tuple. So for that I can directly assign a tuple and change it over this key. Okay, and here we can see that the value of this particular key has got changed from string to a tuple. Okay, similarly if I wanted to change a value of a key, of whatever key, then I can use this method, but here it will throw an error. But it didn't throw an error, but what it did, it just added this new key and a new value. Why is this so? Because my previous key was 673, that was of integer type, and here I have defined a key, what that key is of a string type. So basically Python program doesn't knows that there is no difference between 673 and string 673. It considers these things as a separate things, and that's why we can see that there is one new string, one new key gets added to our dictionary. Okay, so this is all about dictionaries, and we will see dictionary comparisons and all these things into looping statements. So let us move on to conditional statements. Okay, so I hope there is no any problem. Of if you are having any ambiguity, please let me know, okay, in comments. So let us move on to conditional statements. Okay, so basically we are going to see three type of conditional statements, like if condition, then if else condition, then if nested if condition, and if else if and else, these type of conditions. So basically if condition, when this if condition or if statement is used, or when this execution will happen into a if condition. In if statement is used for decision making. Okay, So whenever we have to make a decision about something, like if I am doing some mathematical operations and I want to know that whether a quantity is greater than something, then we can use if statement. Okay, and when the body, whatever the code is in is between the if condition will get executed if and only if the condition is got satisfied or the return of this condition is true, then only the whatever codes are following into that body of if condition or if statement will get executed. Okay, so here we will see with an example. Like here I have defined a value of a is equal to 5 and I want to here I want to know if a value of a is greater than 3, then only print if a is greater than 3. Okay, so here this when this if statement or when this process of execution will go into this if statement or body of if statement, if this particular command whatever condition is got satisfied. Okay, now here I will define like a is equal to 5. Okay, and now I will try to know if a is greater than 3. So value of a is greater than 3, this condition value of this condition is true. Okay, so because of this value of this condition is true, that's why because of this only this process of execution will go enter into this if condition and it will print that a is greater than 3. Okay, now let us see one more example that if a is less than 5. Okay, so if this condition is true, like if a is less than 5, not 5 exactly, a is equal to 5, so if a is less than 4, print okay, so we know that a is equal to 5, so the output of this a is less than 4, output of this condition will be false. Okay, so let us check what will be the outcome of this. So there is no any output of this cell. The reason is this condition is false because we know that value of a is 5, and if I try to run this command separately, if a is less than 4, the return of this condition is false. Okay, and that's why the process of execution didn't enter into if condition or statement. Okay, and that's why this print statement never executed. Okay, so this is a basic example or basic way of knowing how if else condition works. Okay, so another example here, I have a is equal to 5 and I wanted to know if a is greater than 15. So we know that a is not going to be greater than 15 because a is 5. So basically what does this condition means, 5 is greater than 15, so output of this condition will be false, and that's why it will never execute this print statement, but it will leave this condition and it will execute the below two statements. Okay, so it has executed this statement that if I am not in if hello. Okay, so here one more thing is noticeable that in this print statement and this if statement, the print written over here is in red color. Why is this so? So basically Python programming was entirely based on indentation. Python is basically based on indentation way. Okay, and if there is some change in indentation, then we can see it in the syntax or we can see it in this type of format. Okay, so basically we can how we can make sure our indentation is not wrong. So after if condition or if statement block, please press enter and then make sure that how many indentations are wrong. Okay, the cursor will move on only with that indentation way, and we can make sure how many indentations are wrong or how many spaces we need to provide to make sure the indentation is right. Okay, so basically previously the indentation was one space before, and that's why this print statement was written in red format. But if I give one more space over here, then the color of that print statement will get changed to green. Okay, so basically this is just a basic information, but this is really useful information when you are using web applications or yeah, web applications, and you are going to host all these things into some server or in production environment. Then this type of error may occur, and you have to make sure that your indentations are correct. Okay. Now the another condition, if else condition. Okay, so when to use an if else condition? Like we have some conditions, such as if I want to do this, or if this condition is true, then process this statement, and if this condition is false, then process another set of statements. So when there is some that type of mathematical way of processing another statements, or we wanted to know whether our previous condition is working or not, then we can use else statement. Okay, if else conditions. Okay, like if condition expression in if statement is not satisfied, then enter into else statement. Okay, also there can be one else statement to and if condition, or no else statement to an if condition, but there cannot be more than one else condition to if statement. Okay, so whenever you are programming, you have to make sure that your if condition is satisfied with else, or if condition there has to be one-to-one mapping between if and else. There can be no else statement to a if condition, but there cannot be a extra else statement. Okay, so if you place any extra else statement, the Python program will throw an error, like it may be a syntax error or anything else. Okay, so let us move on to examples of this if else conditions. Okay, now I have my value of a is equal to 20, and now I want to check whether I have here one condition that a is less than 15. So we know that value of a is 20, so whatever be the output of this condition will be, or this condition will be evaluated as 20 is less than 15, so output of this condition will be false. Okay, so that's why the process of execution will go directly into else condition, else statement, and it will write whatever we have written, or whatever execution we want to execute in else condition. Okay, so this is how it will print that a is greater than 15. Okay, so let us see another example, like b is equal to 155, and if b is less than 100, print b is less than 100, else print b is greater than 100. Okay, so here also we can see that our this condition was not satisfied, that's why our whole process of execution entered into else statement, and that's why it printed b is greater than 100. So let us see one more example of this thing, like c is equal to 5, 4, and if c is less than 5, print c is less than 5, else c is greater okay So here we can see that this first condition was satisfied, that we know that c is less than 5, and that's why it the process of execution entered into if statement. But because it entered into if statement, it never entered into else condition, okay? Because this one condition was satisfied, that's why our process of execution didn't enter into else, and that's why our output is c is greater than 5, okay? So this is how we see both conditions, like if condition is not satisfied, the process of execution will enter into else condition, else body, and if condition is satisfied, then it will never enter into else condition, okay? So now nested if else statements. When we call a statement or a block of statement is a nested if else statement. If nested if statements means that if statements are inside another if statement, okay? So previously I have defined one if condition, and if I define one more if condition into the process into the body of that if statement, then our whole programming will be called as nested if else statements, okay? So basically, like, this is my if condition. If then whatever condition I want to place, then always make sure that Python works in this colon statements, okay? Then we have to press one press some indentation, like whatever but the natural indentation will be, and then whatever we keep it here, it will be the process of body. If this condition satisfies, then only this condition will get executed. Whatever command we press, that will get executed. Then we can again press if condition, if then condition, then colons, and then in in indentation we have to press we have to write whatever we want to execute in this another condition. Okay, so this is how this if this nested if else statements works. Okay, so let us see an example. Like here I have a is equal to 20. Okay, now I will check whether a is greater than 10. So we know that 20 is greater than 10, and so that's why this condition is satisfied. So we will check another one condition, that if a is less than 10, that 20 is less than 15. So this condition is not satisfied, so that's why this entire process will not print anything, okay? So like here we can say that print a is greater than 10, okay? So after this condition we know that a is greater than 10, that's why this printing will happen. But when it will check the second condition, it will fail into that. The output of this condition is false, that's why it will never enter into this condition, and it will just get out of this whole if condition, and it will try to understand what are these values, okay? So now here it will check that if a is less than 12, so the value of a is 20, so we know that a is not less than 12, so it will not enter into this condition, but it will into else, and it will say that, or we can print out here like a is greater than 12, okay? So when I run this entire command, we get to know that a is greater than 10 and it is greater than 12. So it entered into first condition because this condition was satisfied. It didn't enter into this condition, this process or this execution, this line, because this condition was not satisfied. Then it checked for this condition was false, that's why it never ran into this line, and it directly moved on to else condition, and this it ran it gone through this line, okay? So that's why our output is a is greater than 12. Again we will see one example, like b is equal to 15, okay? And now if b is less than 20, print b is less than 20. Again I would like to keep one else if condition. Again I would like to check if b is less than 17, print b is less than 17. Again, after this if statement, I would like to check another one statement, like into this if condition also, that if b is less than 15, print b is less than 15. Okay, so this is how exactly the nested if else statement works. Okay, so here, or else print b is less than or equal to 15. Okay, so this is just printing whatever I want to done. I want to do. So here we know that value of b is 15, and here we will check our first condition to check is whether 15 is less than 20. So out of this thing will be true, and that's why it will run this command. So it will print, first it will print that b is less than 20. Okay, so then it will check this another condition, like whether b is less than 17. The output of this condition is 15 is if 15 is less than 17, so that is also true. So this will again run into this this statement, and it will write like b print or b is less than 17. Now it will check this line, and here the condition will fall because b is not strictly less than 15, but b is less than or equal to 15. So that's why it will never run this b is less than 15 command, or it will never print this b is less than 15 command, but it will enter into else condition, and it will write that b is less than or equal to 15. Okay, so let us see the output of this above coding. So here we see that now, as explained above, the whole process has got undergone. This condition was true because that's why this statement statement was printed. This condition was true because that's why this statement was printed. This condition was false because that's why this condition did not got printed, but it entered into else and it printed this statement. Okay, so this is how nested if and else statements works. Okay, so now we will see last part of if else conditions, that is if, else if, and else statements. Okay, so basically what is this condition and why it is used? It is the same way as we used nested if else conditions over here, but here we can see that indentation was getting increased each and every time. Okay, so that's why the uses are different also when we are using else if conditions. When condition of when first condition is not in else if and el if conditions statements, if a first condition is not satisfied, then it will enter into second condition or it will enter into else condition. It will check that if the second condition is satisfied or not. If that condition is satisfied, it will execute whatever lines are there into second condition, and it will print it will execute it, and it will directly get out of this whole loop, if else conditions loop. Okay, and it will stop over there. Now consider when I am writing some when I am using some conditions, and if my first condition is true, then whatever I have written over here, that will get executed, and my whole process will get stopped. Okay, another way of example will be my first it will check for my first condition is true or not. If it is false, then it will go for a second condition. It will check whether that second condition is true or not. If that true is false, then it will enter into third condition. If that true is false, then it will enter into else block, if you have placed that else block over there, or it will just stop. Okay, so let us see with an example. Like here, my value of a is 10. I want to check. So now in first if condition, the condition is a is greater than or equal to 20. So here 10 is greater than or equal to 20. The value of this condition will be false because a is 10. Okay, 10 is never greater than or equal to 20. So this will not enter into this processing block. It will directly go to else condition. But in else there is also one statement over here. It will check that if a is greater than or equal to 15. So here the value will be like the condition will be 10 is greater than or equal to 15. The output of this condition will be false. That's why it will enter into the another else condition, and it will check whether if a is greater than or equal to 10. Now 10 is always equal greater than or equal to 10. That means 10 is equal to 10, but the condition the output of this condition will be true, and that's why it will print that a is greater than or equal to 10. Okay, so this is how the if else if and else condition works. So let us see one more example of this this type of conditions. Like consider b is equal to 20. Now I wanted to check if b is greater than 10, print b is greater than 10. If it is greater than 10, okay. Okay, so this is the execution code. So now I have written this code, like value of b is 20, and I wanted to check whether b is greater than 10. Okay, so the output of this condition will be true. Okay, so that's why it will enter into this, like print b is greater than 10, and the whole process will get stopped. Okay, but it will never enter into this and this condition. Okay, so like this, here we can see that the value of b is greater than 10. Okay, so let us change some conditions, like b is greater than 20. Let us check whether b is greater than 20. So b is equal to 20, but it is not greater than 20. That's why the condition will be false. So it will check whether b is greater than 5 or not. So it will enter into this block, and it will this condition is true. That's why it will enter into this block, and it will print, the program will print that b is greater than 5, and the process will get stopped. Okay, so output of this command will be this. Now again let us check whether check some conditions. Okay, so no, not like that. Okay, so here we can see that this first condition is false. That's why it will not enter into this condition, this statement. It will not execute this statement. It will enter in, it will try to check another condition. The another condition is b is greater than 20. So this condition is also false, and that's why it will enter into else condition, and it will directly print that something is wrong. Okay, so this is how if else and else if el if conditions work. So I hope you got you understand each and everything in depth. If you guys have any problem, please let me know. And on to next videos, we will see looping statements like for loops and while loops, and some data structures, how we can build it in loops, looping. Okay, and if we have some time, then we will go through functions, user defined functions. We will develop some user defined functions also. So up to next time, I will say goodbye, and just keep on practicing each and everything. I will comment this code, or I will put this all this code on GitHub or GitLab, whatever we prefer. Okay, so until then, bye.